Catholic controversies. Vatican leaders respond to questions about tough topics. We have a report from Rome. Abortion agenda. A government agency is taking a new approach to undermine pro-life laws across the nation. We're at the White House. Threat from Iran. Analysis of U.S. airstrikes against targets in Syria. And Princes of the Church. A preview of tomorrow's consistory at the Vatican and why not all of them will vote for the next pope. On EWTN News Nightly for Friday, August 26, 2022. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. I'm Tracy Sable. A Catholic cardinal tells journalists that only the Holy Spirit will be hijacking the church's synod on synodality. The comments came during a press conference at the Holy See press office today. It was just one comment making headlines, especially surrounding the German synodal way. EWTN Vatican Bureau Chief Andreas Thonhauser has more from Rome.
The global synodal process is different from the German one. Cardinal Mario Gregg used clear words today distancing the so-called Synod of Synodality from the German synodal path, where activists and bishops have called for a change of church teachings around controversial topics such as same-sex marriage or ordination of women to the priesthood. Pope Francis started the process of soliciting feedback and opinions from the faithful around the globe only last year. So far, the Secretariat for the Synod has received more than 100 reports from bishop conferences across the globe. Cardinal Gregg expressed his satisfaction with the participation and the positive feedback he and his co-workers have received. Asked about the controversial German synodal path, he quoted from Pope Francis's letter to the German Church. The Holy Father emphasized in it that it was important not to ignore any pressing issues, but to listen to all concerns, without losing the sensus ecclesiae, so the sense of the church. And on a different occasion, Pope Francis also commented on the German synodal path, saying a second Lutheran church would not be needed. Also present at today's press conference was Cardinal Jean-Claude Hollerich, the president of the Commission of the Bishops' Conferences of the European Union, in short it's known as COMECE, is the general rapporteur of the Synod of Bishops. This means he will generate the final report and give recommendations to the Holy Father. Recently, Cardinal Hollerich drew a lot of attention regarding a comment on homosexuality and church teaching. He said that it was time for a fundamental revision of doctrine and interpreted Pope Francis' statements on that topic in a way that change might soon occur. Today, he clarified that not a change of doctrine is needed, but a change of attitude. All people should feel welcome in church. Like Cardinal Gregg, Cardinal Hollerich was also optimistic about the synodal process and expressed excitement about the synod, which will be held next year. In Rome, Andreas Thonhauser, EWTN News Nightly.
Well, here in the U.S., the Biden administration sends a letter to governors telling them that federal taxpayer dollars are available in the form of a Medicaid waiver for women traveling across state lines seeking abortions. This as President Joe Biden meets with pro-abortion supporters. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports. Owen.
Tracy, the letter is also a stern warning that, quote, states cannot avoid their responsibilities under federal law. We'll get to more of that letter in a moment. First, the White House says it is marking a day of action on reproductive rights, and President Biden is doubling down despite the teachings of his own Catholic faith.
President Joe Biden tells state and city officials,
the court got Roe right for nearly 50 years, and Congress, in my view, should codify Roe for once and for all.
A local leader from Houston told the president,
it was tragic. Just yesterday, the trigger law in Texas came into effect, and it means that abortion is banned from the time of fertilization.
Just today, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, in discussing what it refers to as abortion care, told governors in a letter, states interested in federal Medicaid funding to expand access to care within the scope of Medicaid's legal authority for women traveling from a state that has restricted or prohibited abortion are encouraged to engage with the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. But former Vice President Mike Pence, a pro-lifer, shared videos from a speech he gave.
We must not rest. We must not relent until we restore the sanctity of life to the center of law in every state in America. 50 years of praying and fasting and working and striving. We stand today at long last when Roe v. Wade has been sent to the ash heap of history where it belongs.
Now, keep in mind in all of this, the Biden administration must operate under the Hyde Amendment, which prevents federal taxpayer dollars from paying for abortions. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
Well, this week we brought you the story of how the review site Yelp is censoring pregnancy care centers across the nation. And now, at the request of congressional Democrats, the search engine Google is now suppressing results for those who offer alternatives to abortions. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales reports.
Here's how it works when you type in the Google search engine, "Find me the nearest abortion clinic." Only on the map, abortion clinics are shown. They used to include pregnancy care centers. Those have been pushed to the very bottom. Now, even if a pregnancy care center is an ad, it'll show up on top, but it has a disclaimer says, does not provide abortions. Congressional Democrats pressured Google into making this happen. In the letter sent to Google, Senator Warner and 20 other Democrats urged the tech giant to limit the appearance or add user-friendly disclaimers of pro-life clinics in search results. The Democrats said that they want to ensure women seeking health care services are directed to the basic information they request.
I think if women aren't even given the space to have non-judgmental information-based counseling, that it could increase the number of abortions.
Susan Gallucci with the Northwest Center, a pregnancy care center in D.C., says this push by congressional Democrats to limit their exposure is the latest since the Supreme Court's decision in the Dobbs versus Jackson women's health case. Across the country, crisis pregnancy centers have been vandalized. Many of these attacks have not been federally investigated because the Justice Department refuses to intervene. The Democrats' letter cites a report from the Center for Countering Digital Hate, a nonprofit that has advocated for big tech censorship in the United Kingdom. Researchers recorded pregnancy care centers as, quote, anti-abortion fake clinics. Gallucci says there's nothing fake about the love and support they provide.
Not only do some provide medical services, but almost all of them provide other material support like diapers and baby clothes, as well as that emotional support, just to have someone listen and say, if you want to do this, you can do this, and I'll walk alongside you.
Pregnancy care center executives tell me that they will continue their work and provide a safe place for women and their unborn baby. At the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
The Justice Department has released a redacted version of the sworn statement that led to the search of former President Donald Trump's Florida home. The 32-page document claims 15 boxes of government papers were not authorized for storage at Mar-a-Lago. The unsealed affidavit is extensively blacked out, which the government claimed was necessary to protect an ongoing criminal investigation. The former president argues that he had declassified a portion of the records in question. Well, U.S. Federal Reserve Chair Jerome Powell says Americans should expect interest rates to keep rising in order to tame inflation. That means higher costs for things like home and car loans. Still, President Joe Biden says overall consumer costs are down and incomes are up. The United States condemns Nicaragua for human rights abuses. The Ortega government recently arrested a Catholic bishop. Our own Owen Jensen asked the White House about it yesterday.
I'm sure the White House is aware of this, the latest persecution of Catholics there in Nicaragua. What's the White House response to these latest developments?
So there has been a dramatic deterioration of respect for democratic principles and human rights by the regime in Nicaragua, including the imprisonment of democratic leaders, members of the political opposition, students, and journalists. The Biden-Harris administration finds this unacceptable and condemns these actions. The United States and members
White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre notably did not directly reference the attacks against Catholics. Well, the Pentagon says U.S. military airstrikes earlier this week killed four Iranian-backed militia members. The strikes targeted the insurgents while they were in Syria. The Pentagon says the attack was in response to recent strikes, including one earlier this week against U.S. service members. Those attacks are blamed on groups backed by Tehran. And we go now to James Phillips, Senior Research Fellow for Middle Eastern Affairs at the Heritage Foundation. James, thanks so much for joining us today. We appreciate it. A lot to get to regarding Iran, but first, let's talk about the U.S. airstrikes. Your thoughts, and do you think it was the appropriate response?
I think it was the appropriate response. Iran's proxy militias that is mobilized from throughout the Middle East, including Shiite Muslim militants from Lebanon that belong to Hezbollah, and groups of Shia from Iraq, from Syria, from Yemen, and the group that the U.S. hit reportedly was an Afghan Shia militia that Iran mobilized as part of its foreign legion. These groups have been attacking the roughly 900 U.S. forces that are still in Syria to prevent ISIS from reemerging.
And James, what has been Iran's response to the strikes, and what type of impact do you think this will have as the Biden administration seeks to revive the Iran nuclear deal?
Iran denies it has any connection to this militia, which is a joke. As usual, it's lying through its teeth. I don't think Iran will react because it's denied that it itself was attacked. But I think this is a sign that the Biden administration must take into account Iran's duplicity and continued attacks as it's looking at the Iran nuclear deal, because Iran's regime cannot be trusted on either front.
Yeah, and as you know, earlier this week, the European Union proposed a draft agreement to revive the Obama-era deal. What do we know about that EU draft and apparently, I guess, some concessions that were made by Iran?
Well, we know that whatever emerges is going to be shorter and more risky than the original nuclear agreement signed back in 2015. And unfortunately, it looks like it keeps the same sunset deadlines. That is, the key restrictions on Iran's nuclear program dissolve, they sunset, and by the year 2030, Iran will be in a position to sprint to a nuclear weapon under this deal, even if it maintains all its obligations under the deal. At the end of it, it will be in a much better position, and it will have billions of dollars in sanctions relief from the U.S. that will not only strengthen it and strengthen its threat to the U.S., but strengthen its threat to U.S. allies in the region.
Yeah, and the Biden administration has signaled that it may support this draft proposal, but of course not everyone is on board, especially Israel. Let's talk a little bit more about that and Israel's concerns.
Well, today, Israeli Defense Minister Benny Gantz was meeting with the U.S. National Security Council advisor Jake Sullivan, and he reportedly stressed to the U.S. that it needs not only economic sanctions, but a military option if it's going to hold Iran's feet to the fire and deter Iran from future attacks. And I think that message is the correct one, because I don't believe that economic sanctions alone will stop Iran from getting a nuclear weapon any more than they stopped North Korea. It's important to have a credible military option so that Iran knows that if it breaks the deal, it will pay a heavy price.
Well, James, thank you so much for your time today and for weighing in. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Coming up, ahead of tomorrow's consistory, we take a look at the 20 soon-to-be princes of the church. St. St. Peter's Basilica hosts a major event tomorrow. Pope Francis will hold a consistory that will lead to the creation of 20 new cardinals. This is the first consistory since November 2020. EWTN and Catholic News Agency journalist Hannah Brockhaus provides a preview.
Tomorrow, 20 new princes of the Church will be declared in the 8th consistory of Pope Francis's pontificate. The Holy Father announced the new cardinals in May.
Sabato, 27 agosto, terrò un consistorio per la...
Among the future cardinals, there are three heads of dicasteries of the Curia. 16 will be cardinal electors, and four, respectively, are over 80 years of age. In the group, there are five Italians, while the youngest, at just 48 years of age, is Bishop Giorgio Marengo, the apostolic prefect of Ulaanbaatar, capital of Mongolia. After this new consistory, there will be 132 cardinals under the age of 80, thus eligible to vote for a new pope in a conclave. With this consistory, the electors created by Pope Francis will be 83 out of 132, more than double the 38 made by Pope Benedict XVI. With the new consistory, three nations will have cardinals for the first time. Paraguay, with Adalberto Martinez Flores, the Archbishop of Asunción. Singapore, with Bishop William Seng Chai Ga. And East Timor, with the Salesian Virgilio do Carmo da Silva, Archbishop of Dili. For the first time, there will also be a cardinal in the Archdiocese of Manaus, in Brazil, the Franciscan Leonardo Ulrich Steiner. Notably, the Bishop of Como, Italy, specifically Oscar Cantoni, will once again be a cardinal after more than three centuries without one. The last one was in fact Carlo Stefano Anastasio Ciccioli in the 17th century. Significant appointments include Bishop Robert Walter McElroy for the United States, who has been at the helm of the Diocese of San Diego since March of 2015. Also, Bishop Peter Okpalik for Nigeria. Okpalik was appointed Bishop of Ahiara in December of 2012, but was never able to take possession of the diocese due to opposition from clergy because he was from a different ethnic group. In 2018, after attempts to reconcile the bishop and local clergy failed, Pope Francis decided to accept Okpalik's resignation without appointing a new bishop, later assigning him a new diocese. The pope will create new cardinals also of Jean-Marc Avelin, Archbishop of Marseille, Felipe Neri Antonio Sebastiao do Rosario Ferrao, Archbishop of Goa and Dumao, India, Anthony Pula, Archbishop of Hyderabad, India, Paulo Cesar Costa, Archbishop of Brasilia, and Richard Bawober, Archbishop of Ouagana. The Holy Father also named two recently appointed heads of dicasteries in the Englishman Arthur Roche, Prefect of the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments, and the Korean Lazaro Yu Heung-sik, Prefect of the Congregation for Clergy. He also named the Spaniard Fernando Verguez Azaga of the Legionaries of Christ, who is the president of the Governorate of the Vatican City State. Tomorrow, Pope Francis will assign the cardinalate also to four men over 80 years of age, three of them Italians, Arrigo Mio, Archbishop Emeritus of Cagliari, Father Gianfranco Ghirlanda, and Monsignor Fortunato Frezza, as well as the Colombian, Jorge Enrique Jimenez Carvajal. In Rome, Hannah Brockhaus, EWTN News Nightly.
St. Teresa of Calcutta is remembered on her birthday. The missionaries of Calcutta participated in a special mass to mark the 112th anniversary of her birth. Mother Teresa founded the religious order back in 1950 to serve the sick and poor and was declared a saint in 2016. Up next, sports business. How a new golf tour backed by Saudi Arabia is affecting the PGA. Finally tonight, the PGA Tour has made its boldest response to date against a rival professional golf league funded by Saudi Arabia. Commissioner Jay Monahan announced a plan earlier this week for the best players to commit to a 20-tournament schedule. It would start next year and is set to double the PGA Tour's prize money. The news comes amid the formation of the LIV Golf League. The Saudi-funded initiative is offering prize money of at least $150 million. And joining us now is Doug Eldridge, founder and managing partner of DLE Agency and Achilles Public Relations. Doug, great to see you again. All right, for those who aren't familiar, tell us more about the LIV Golf League and why it's come under so much criticism, that is.
So the LIV Tour was started in large part by Saudi Arabia, and it was designed to be perhaps an inadvertent competitor to the PGA Tour. Essentially, it's seven stops, 54 holes or three rounds of golf, played all around the world. Now, the big draw was the money that they were throwing at some of the biggest names in the sport. Now, Tiger Woods recently confirmed that he was offered around $1 billion with a B dollars to play in the tournament. Phil Mickelson got $200 million, and a variety of other players going down the line got $125, $100 million, and so on. The criticism was mounted because some claim a couple of things. Number one, the connections between Saudi Arabia and the 9/11 attacks. Number two, the purported connections between MBS and the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, the journalist. Number three, a variety of purported human rights transgressions spanning years. And then number four, what some critics are calling sports washing, which is to say using a high-profile sporting event as essentially a Trojan horse to do some image rehab. But it's important to counter that with a couple of things, if we're calling balls and strikes here, no pun intended. Number one, if we're laying these two track records side by side and redacted the name, since that's a popular buzzword right now, would China be any better in terms of the human rights category? And yet the NBA and every major Hollywood production company is reliant upon the Chinese economy to sell their product. The NBA lost $400 million when a general manager posted an innocuous tweet 2 years ago about Hong Kong. And then secondly, you have countries like the UAE, who sponsors a Tour de France team that just won the yellow jersey 2 years ago. You have Qatar, who's hosting the World Cup here later this year. So the criticism is really met with mixed reviews, but this is quickly becoming a front page, not just a sports page story.
All right. I'll try not to create another word here, scrutiny and criticism. But anyway, I understand the PGA Tour, Doug, has banned players who try to play in both tournaments. I'm curious, why is that? I mean, you would think that it might be good for the game to have more competitions and maybe open it up to a wider audience.
You would think that, right? And actually, this has quickly devolved into an antitrust case as well, right? Because the allegation is, wait a minute, if there is not a collective bargaining agreement like there is in the NFL, which prevents NFL players under contract, just to draw a parallel here, prevents NFL players under contract from playing in a competing league, be it the CFL in Canada or the Arena League or the XFL, which The Rock has purchased and is going to relaunch. As long as you're under contract, you can't play in another league simultaneously. The PGA, when all of this started, did not have any type of binding language that prevented players from doing that. So for them to all of a sudden put the squeeze on players, for sponsors that are unfortunately caught in the middle, both with relationships with the players on the endorsement side, as well as PGA-wide sponsorships, they were cutting ties with players. And so really, if we want to talk about collusion, this was in some ways a prime example of that. And so this has quickly run up the flagpole, and DOJ is looking at this from an antitrust standpoint because they were essentially saying, you can't play in a competitor league. We don't have binding regulations that prevent you to, but like the old parent yelling in the back seat, because I said so. And it's really drawn a lot of criticism. So again, this story is only ratcheting up higher and higher.
Doug, we have probably less than 20 seconds left or so, but final thoughts on all this.
It's going to be interesting to see where it goes. You know, sometimes this money goes away as quickly as it appears. I mean, you're talking about unquestionably the wealthiest nation, at least in modern history and perhaps in all of Earth history. If this is going to still be an issue and a controversy 5 or 10 years from now, I don't know. I tend to agree with you. Healthy competition is good for the game. It's good for the sport. And it's best for the fans. So whatever the case may be, let's level the playing field and let the best players and the best chips fall where they may.
All right, Doug, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it, and we'll see how things shake out.
Thank you for having me.
And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.